I'm Scott Al Miller, and this is my life living in Latin America today. We're going to take a little bit of a different tact. We often talk about relocation or travel or living abroad, all kinds of different topics. And yes, today's topic is going to play into that. But I want to give a little bit more of a general bit of life advice. We had some interesting feedback. For a number of videos that Yosef had questions about relocating his stuff and thinking about moving abroad and where it's going to make sense. And this isn't a response to Yosef, but it's a response to some of the people who responded to Yosef. And I think that there's some really good general advice that applies more strongly to expats that will help your expat journey be safer, more fulfilling, more successful. But these are things that will apply broadly, whether you're looking to become an expat or not. And so I think this is some really good stuff that we want to cover. Some of it's going to be just very how to think about your personal life, and some of it is going to be more technical and understanding some places where foreign governments from here, some large consumer governments are guiding you in ways that are probably pretty unhealthy for you because they're beneficial to the larger economy. These are really important things to think about. So we're going to dive into some really interesting topics that are a little bit different than we normally touch on right after the bump. To get us started today, I want to talk about the concept of thinking about your personal life as if it was a business. Now, I come from a business consulting background. I've been a business consultant actively full-time since 1999 with my own firm and worked in different realms of business consulting for a number of years. Before that, whether it was as a private consultant or whether it was an internal consultant working in things like restaurants and hotels where I would help with management problems internally. But I've done this for a very long time and started in my technical journey 35 years ago. So these are a lot of experience I have here. Now, when we're in business, one of the things that's really important, one of the things that defines something as a business as opposed to a hobby, for example, is when people sit down and make their decisions based on the financial return at the end of the day. Everything that a true business does, and in many cases, like in the United States, if a publicly traded company does something, it legally, under the term fiduciary responsibility, must be making all their decisions around what provides the best return on investment or what the greatest profits at the end of the day. This is really straightforward. If you're doing anything else as a business, how can you claim to be a business, right? You're specifically not doing business. So that's kind of obvious, but even in the business world, most businesses struggle really, really hard with this concept. And partially that's because in many publicly traded companies, there's easily more money for the average worker to be made, not by doing the best thing for the company, but by actually taking advantage of the investors and siphoning off their money instead of making them money. This is just the harsh realities of publicly traded companies where the owners are not sitting there watching what's going on and auditing the books, but are kept at arm's length by managers who all make their money by keeping the investors a little bit farther away. Okay, so that's just going into some reality, but businesses really struggle with these concepts every day. You can sit down with small businesses where the owner is present and say things like you need to be thinking about how you're making money with all your decisions and stop making decisions based on other factors because it's a business. What other factor could you ever consider? And when you isolate it, they go, nothing. Of course, that's the only factor. And the moment you have a real decision, they will consider everything except money. Humans are emotional. And this is one of the reasons why businesses fail on such an epic scale. It's hard to believe that someone would go out, spend their time and effort and money, start up a business when there's an 85% fail rate or something like that over a course of years. And I realize that that exact number is kind of a myth, but it's a really high fail rate. If you talk to people who go into business, even those that will talk about it and admit it, the number of them who have failed is really, really high. And so it's a really scary thing. And to imagine going into that and then just being lost in this emotional turmoil that is so likely to cause you to lose your business, it's unbelievable that people do that. Now, when we move to our personal lives, it's really easy to say, look, Scott, I understand this for business. That totally makes sense. Businesses exist to make money. People do not exist to make money, contrary to what you may be taught in school or what the government hopes you will do with your time. You are not existing to generate profits for other people. They want to have you do that, but that is not your function. Your function is to live your own life and to enjoy it. And I'm never quite sure how to wear this hat. I love this hat, but on camera, it's hard to do, and the dogs are out of control. So it's easy to become lost in the, well, how do we make decisions about our own lives? But it's important that there is no actual exception from good business decision making, but there are some differences in our personal life that we can apply that fix this. It is not a paradox and it is not an exception. It is that there is a component we often overlook. That component is emotional value. So now, because we discussed it recently, I'm going to use Yosef's example, but this is in no way based on Yosef himself. It's just that we have the example that he gave. When we're talking about moving his stuff down, on one side, I'm giving a purely financial picture. This is how much it's going to cost, what it's going to do to you, how it's going to affect you long-term, purely in a numbers game. And he is looking at it with this additional picture of, but these are things that provide me comfort, security. We're talking about like his books, his DVDs, things like that, other things that he owns in life, has collected over the years, and having his possessions around him gives him a certain emotional tie back to the United States, wherever he's moving from, to his past life, and lets him connect better into the new one. So he's articulating an important emotional value of what it's worth to him to have, why he wants to do something that is, if you were to look at it purely financially, like I typically am, doesn't make sense. And he's completely correct that there is that value. What's missing in the discussion and is extremely difficult to do is putting a number on that value. So this is an important piece that we have to at least understand exists under the hood, whether we're able to do so or not, or whether we think it's worth doing or not. But in the case of Yosef, let's say he has 1,000 books and 1,000 DVDs, and he can look at how much it costs to move them, how much it's going to try to calculate, how much effort is going to go into all these pieces, right? He's got to box them up, make sure he has them, put them on a pallet, get them on a shipper, pay that shipper pay someone to take it to a shipping location, pay the shipper to bring it to Nicaragua or wherever he's going to, he's not coming to Nicaragua, pay them to then bring it to his location there. He wants to buy a storage unit. He needs to then store the storage unit. Presumably he'll own the land, so that's basically free, but it's still going to be a storage unit sitting there. So that's a potential negative emotional value for a lot of us. That would be I don't want a storage unit sitting in my lawn for any amount of time, but maybe he doesn't mind. And then he's got to do the effort of unloading it. He's got to come up with bookshelves or somewhere to store it in the house. He has to realize that it's very humid here and it's the tropics, so things like books just fall apart really quickly. DVDs, not so much a problem. Older laser discs die here really quickly if they haven't died already from oxidation. And so there's a lot of things that simply don't make sense here and you don't realize it because you haven't come in and experienced the weather, and people forget that the place that they live in, a lot of the decisions they've made about what they own and which types of things they own are actually based around things like weather, power supply, and so forth that will change from place to place. And you can be caught by surprise that things that are really obvious and normal where you come from don't make sense where you're moving to, maybe because it would cause mold to accumulate or something else. Now, on the one side, the way that I'm looking at it from the financial picture, it's relatively easy to lay these things out and say, okay, what is the value, what is the cost of getting those books and DVDs and such to your new location? And then what is the risk that they will be lost, that they will be damaged, that they will be stolen, or that you might need to move them again in the future, whether internationally, you decide that the country you move to isn't the right one for you, or intranationally, okay, but the city you're in isn't the right one, or intra-municipally, this apartment is great, but this is where I'm living right now. I'm going to move over to this other house. And so that cost will be probably really tiny, but if it's moving internationally, it could be really large. What if you have to move back to your original home country? Plus, you have to think about any potential imports in the meantime, any delays, like, I don't want to pay import duties on it, so I'm going to wait to get residency. That could take a long time. I could rush that, but then am I spending extra money or making bad decisions because I'm rushing a residency that I'm only rushing so that I don't pay import on things that I want to bring in? And so forth. So you want to look at that picture. And I understand that's a lot of things I just mentioned, and that's a relatively simple financial analysis. Right now, on the other side, he needs to flip that and say, okay, so that's the negative. What's the positive? The positive is the emotional value that you're going to get from having these physical objects. We already established that he can have them non-physically for free for less effort without any of the risk. So we know that the actual book, the stories of the books, the ability to read the books, that's not in question. The ability to watch the movies, that's not in question. It's the physical books, the physical media sitting on the shelves is the only component we're discussing. And we're going to get more into that later in the video, but because of the other questions that people have to ask. So the question is, what is the emotional value of that. Put a number on it. And I know it sounds terrible to put a financial number, a dollar value on emotions, but that is how you do this. There is no exception to this. At some point, you say, is it worth $1,000 to me to have the physical copies of these things? Is it worth $10,000? Is it worth $100,000? And easily for some people, but you have to be honest, right? Don't lie about this, because you will simply, you're simply admitting that you know there isn't the value and you're not going to analyze it, right? To yourself, right? You're screwing yourself over. You're not going to screw over other people. I'm trying to help you, right? I don't care if you bring your books and DVDs or whatever it is or not, right? I don't care how you make these decisions, but I don't want to be responsible for you having bad decision-making processes. I'm exposing how you can make your own life better across the board. This is just an example case of how to make this decision. You would use these same tools to make decisions about what car to buy or which house to get or which subscription service to subscribe to or so forth, right? You come up with this emotional value and say, okay, so for me, for example, I own a bunch of antique computers that I've stored for a number of years. So I've already lost a bunch of money storing them. That makes them more emotional to me, even though it does not change their value. That would be sunk cost, and you'd have to be insane to consider that. But people often do, and people often are insane. That's a real thing. So I have these computers. I bought them originally. I went through the effort of collecting them. They are very difficult to reobtain. At the time, they were pretty easy. Now they'd be extremely hard. They're all working. And they are things that they're the one collection that I have that's really meaningful to me. If you were to say I have to spend $10,000 to bring them to Nicaragua, I would say I can't justify that. That is way too much money to bring them down, even though I'd love to have them. But if you said it was $1,000 to bring them down, I'd say, yes, I would spend $1,000 to keep those items. And the alternative is that they just disappear, presumably given away. I'd feel really bad if they were like thrown out, but they're all worth something. So even if they were given away and I got not a penny for them, I would at least not be completely devastated. But spending $1,000 or even $2,000 to bring them to me, well worth it. They're things that have emotional value, but very few other things that I own could I put that kind of value on. I got lots of things. They said, well, you could get it there for $10 or $20 if it's a large item or a set of items. Yes, that's a great value to have that thing that I want to have with me. But in many cases, it costs much more than that. So I have to put an emotional dollar value on all those things. And if someone said, oh no, to be able to keep these, it's going to cost you $10,000. I would immediately say that's way over my emotional threshold for that item. And I could say the same thing to my children. They have a bunch of things that we have in storage that are from their childhoods and they want to keep. Now, the reason that we do this is because we know about what it's going to cost to keep and bring them. And it's worth it to us that we've done that calculation. And it's like, yes, it is a bit of money, but it's a very isolated number of things. And it's a one-time cost. And we've run the numbers. If we sat down with our kids and said, it's going to cost us this few thousand dollars for you to keep these things, my children would probably say, no, it's not worth that much to us. But presumably, we're not going to tell them because we think it's worth it to us to be able to give them those things from their childhood. But if we were to say, oh, it's going to be $10,000, they would instantly be like, you're crazy. Throw them out. That's not worth it. We're not going to pay. If we had to pay in the future, we're not going to pay $500 to keep them. 50, yes. 500, no. You shouldn't pay $10,000 for something we wouldn't pay $500 for. So it really is something you can put this number on, but you have to break yourself of making excuses that your emotions have unlimited value or that dollars cannot be associated with your emotions. It's difficult and it's fungible and it moves from time to time. Emotions are difficult. But in everyday life, we make these decisions. When I'm buying a cell phone, for example, because I need this, I have to have a cell phone for so many things in life. There's no way to consider not having a cell phone, right? It's not safe. So I always have a cell phone. When I'm choosing which cell phone, I could buy a really cheap one for $200 or $300. I could get a really expensive one for, I don't know, $1,400, $1,500 these days, and lots of things in between. When I'm looking to choose a cell phone that's going to make sense for me, I have to look at many factors that are, you know, how does the camera affect me? How does the storage affect me? How does the ability to download apps and which apps are available and many things I look at. And then I look at the prices and I try to consider which ones make the most financial sense. But I do apply some emotional factors as well. Well, this one, the cameras aren't quite as good as this other one. I do photography a lot. It's not going to be a financial difference, but if you said, would you pay $200 extra to have for the next 2 years to have this upgraded camera? Yes, emotionally, I can put that number on it and say, yeah, that is worth it to me because that's something I use nearly every day and many, many times a day. And it just makes me happy. Is $200 worth it for that specific type of my happiness over the next 2 years? Yes. And there'll be some value when I pass it on to my kids, but only a couple dollars at that point. So that mitigates it minusculely. But these kinds of things I do think about with every single thing that I buy or anything of any size. Right. And that's important because it means that I can defend basically every purchasing decision that I make. Maybe not actually even, the amount of time that I put into even considering buying a completely stationary little phone stand that goes on my desk, it was like $8. I didn't just run out and buy one. I thought about it. I looked at a couple different places. I found one that I thought was cute, seemed to have exactly the features that I wanted, which is basically none, right? But a very, very basic thing. And I love it. It works great. It's perfect. It was $8. And I can defend that decision really, really easily. And basically everything that I have, every GoPro, every camera, every vehicle, everything that we purchase of any size, while you could make reasonable arguments as to why I made bad decisions about them, I can at least demonstrate exactly how I came to the conclusion that I did in every case. Why this camera? Why this battery? Why did I order it in this way? Why did I go with this model, this type of thing? And why did I need this thing at all? And sometimes it's, you know, with the Rode microphones that I'm going to get, Eric likes to joke that I'm really passionate about these new pod mics that I'm going to get, but they're beautiful. They're in white. My wife will say, yeah, he has a lot of emotional value in having a, you know, it's a company he really likes. I've tested a lot of their mics. I really like their quality and I find it really beautiful. And I think having it on my desk is going to make me feel good about my working environment. That has emotional value. Is it worth $300? No. Is it worth 20 extra dollars over a competitor that doesn't look as attractive but sounds just as good or nearly like I wouldn't notice the difference? Yes. Yes, it is to me. I can say that an $80 mic that I find less attractive rather than the $100 one that I find more attractive, that's a spot where that $20 makes sense, but another $200 does not. Somewhere in between, there's a difficult threshold to figure out. Luckily, in this case, I don't need to figure that out. But those are ways to look at it. And I do that with all my purchases. And I have for a long time. And it makes me, one, I'm able to avoid things like buyer's remorse. When I get to the end, I can always replay my logic and say, nope, this is exactly what made sense. Why would I regret making the right financial decision? I don't. Now, where people get derailed is they don't reasonably look at their own emotions and say, what is my emotional payoff from this? They say, well, I'm just going to let my emotions make the decision and assume that my emotions have so much value that I don't need to make sound financial decisions. And people defend this concept constantly. Everyone who goes shopping at a sale because they're driving by and they see a sale sign, that's letting your emotions drive everything. And that's why fake sales, where they inflate the price and then bring it back to its real price, or maybe even not all the way back to this real price, it's still inflated with a fake sale, is a common thing. And people joke about it all the time. It's a running joke in America and most of the world about people who can't resist the sale sign. You can tell them that it's not actually a lower price or not even a good price. And they're like, but it's on sale. That line, but it's on sale, is I'm 100% disabling my financial reason. Logic is out the window. Now it's emotion only. Once that happens, people can take advantage of you so easily. You will take advantage of yourself. It's bad. And you will end up with buyer's remorse and a lot less money and a lot fewer things than you should have had you been looking at it more logically. So this is an area where all of us can greatly improve our lives by sitting down and making purchasing decisions a little bit more intentional and understanding that there is never actually a time where we can say, nope, this is purely an emotional decision. I can't apply logic to it. No, logic always applies, always. And yes, as a society, we have excused being irrational when we're buying things for really unhealthy reasons. But because we do that, we have this feeling like I'm allowed to be irrational and illogical and emotional about things. And legally, yes, it's your money, your life. You are allowed to be reckless and foolish, but people feel that they can then be justified in doing so. And that's where it's not true. There's really never a time where you can justify that you were doing something smart or good for yourself. You are doing self-harm by giving in to emotions and then arguing that you should be allowed to be self-harming. If you were to be cutting yourself, we would argue that that is a thing that requires medical attention because you're harming yourself physically. But if you're harming yourself emotionally or financially in the same way, why do we allow people to defend it? We shouldn't. We're just looking the other way because once people are defending that, we kind of stop caring about them. And the point of this video is I'm trying to care about people who are going to have this reaction and give you the tools to maybe combat that some by understanding that everyone goes through this and understanding that that's not an excuse and that understanding that making that excuse is an open admission of doing everything wrong and knowing your brain only tries to make that excuse when it has identified that it knows it is making a horrible decision and is trying to stop other people from exposing to you what both you and they already know, and you know that they know. Now, if all these things are so obviously bad and harming, why do we get so much pressure from society? Ignore businesses. Of course, businesses are trying to get your money, so they're going to say this. But why do we get so much pressure from everywhere and so much look the other way from society when we do illogical things that involve a lot of spending? Well, we don't necessarily, and there's some really important things that people watching this video will find interesting and important. So if you come from a consumer society, such as the North American countries, much of the European countries, and potentially even like China, maybe even Vietnam, you're in a country that is producing many of the things that you're going to buy. And even if they're not producing it, they may be assembling it or having a strong sales or sales and additional services features around those items. And so there's a lot of money, a lot of economic activity that comes from getting people to buy things. And it makes a lot of sense. So we'll use the United States because it's the biggest market like this as an example. In the United States, you may produce a widget and you may have a store that sells that widget. And if someone is to go out and buy one of those widgets, you may be paying for the salesperson, for the sales the business owner of the sales company, the store, for the warehouse that does distribution, for the people at the factory, for the factory investors, for the engineers who design the product. There may be a huge number of people who are not all being fed off of your one purchase, but all of them are benefiting from your one purchase. And that one purchase may trickle down the line. And if you spend, let's say, $100, that $100 may be passed on from company to company. Yes, getting smaller with each move, but that salesperson may bring in $100 and hand it to the store that hands $98 to the distributor that hands $90 to the factory that pays $5 to each of the workers and so forth. And each of those transactions counts as another accumulation to the GDP. And so the GDP number that many of those consumer societies use to promote their own measure of success will grow astronomically based off of you buying something you didn't need and nothing of actual value being created. But it looks really good and people feel good because there's a lot of jobs being created because it's happening within their country. So countries that are producing products tend to be consumer societies and promote heavily the idea that shopping is good. Spending your money creates economic activity, makes the government look like they're being successful, makes everyone feel good, even if the overall value of society decreases or remains steady. In some cases, it does increase, but generally not by the amount that you are spending, right? That widget that you bought, it's going to lose value right away. The effort that went into it is already lost to the universe, and the country just lost actual value, yet its GDP went up by maybe $1,000 for that $100 that you spent. This is some crazy stuff, but it's really important numbers. Now, if you come to a country that doesn't produce a lot of things and is not a consumer society, I'll use Nicaragua as the example. We produce very little here. Food, yes, but not a lot of manufactured goods. When we go out and look to buy something, there's really no benefits to the society in doing so. If a Nicaraguan's going to buy that same $100 widget, we'll assume it's one that you don't actually need to survive. It's a luxury widget, whatever, in both cases. That $100 is going to go off to another country, to the United States, in many cases, maybe to China, and they're going to get the majority of that economic activity. In Nicaragua, that money is almost certainly going to leave the country, at least partially. Maybe there's a store inside the country, and they don't measure success by GDP. They really don't care what their GDP is at all. So by generating that economic activity, it does not give the government some reason to say, look what great job we did by getting you to shop and be unwise. So countries that don't tend to manufacture a lot of things, don't tend to be consumer driven, they don't have government and education systems that push the idea that owning lots of stuff is positive. Instead, they tend to push the idea that saving your money or investing, such as holding real estate or businesses or just investment accounts, are wise things to do with your money. Whereas in the United States, just as an example, they tend to push you to buy lots of things, fill your house with stuff, because spending money may not be good for you, but it generally creates economic activity for society. And so everything, whether it's convincing you to go to college when you don't need to, or retiring early, or buying things you don't need, all these things make for positive looking economic activity that raises the GDP number without creating actual value and provides for lower unemployment numbers and so forth. So there's always going to be a push at a societal level created from the top down from economists in those societies to try to convince you to make excuses for shopping when you don't need to. Oh, you feel like you're stressed out? Go do some shopping therapy, right? That's a real thing that people say. That's just another way of saying, I'm going to emotionally drive really bad decision making and financially harm myself, and I'm going to excuse it as a form of therapy. That's really, really unhealthy. Just that you're willing to say that suggests that you probably should be seeing an actual therapist about that mindset. That is crazy self-destructive. You don't want to be spending your money on things that don't increase your value haphazardly. Everyone needs clothes. Everyone needs things, right? And there's both emotional and real value to many of the things that we buy. But we need to evaluate what that is for us to have a healthy life. So the thing about something like a consumer society is that constantly the things that are being pushed on you are not for your benefit, they're for society's benefit. And that's okay, right? That is the job of the government, right? To make society better. They don't care about you as an individual, or not on the same way that they care about society as a whole. And so they're going to always push for things that benefit the government and government officials, of course, but they generally benefit by things that at least look good at a society level, even if they're not actually good. And so it is generally encouraged that the individual harm themselves, because that's often how you get the best things for society. You siphon off the resources of the individuals, but you don't force it. You don't steal it from them. You simply encourage them to make bad decisions. And the average human will leap at any excuse to make bad decisions because it's emotionally fulfilling in the moment. And so they prey on this aspect by saying, oh, no, just make emotional excuses. Don't let Scott tell you that your emotions have a dollar value. They're unlimited value. Shop all you want. Spend all your money. Give your money to the mega corporations, because at the end of the day, 99% of the time, that's who's making the money. Yeah, 1% of the time, some savvy individual who's not part of the big conglomerates, they're going to make that money. They're okay. The big companies don't care that there's a little tiny bits dripping off here and there. They don't care that somebody's out there making good decisions and protecting themselves. They know that they're the minority. They're such a tiny number. As long as the majority give in to these emotions, the system works and the rich get richer, the poor get poorer by the poor's own voluntary means. Nobody's pressuring them. No one's making them make reckless decisions. No one's making them give up their financial power. No one's making them spend all their money unnecessarily, which essentially becomes a tax. I realize they get something for it, right? I need an extra shirt today. Well, you know, you're kind of being taxed. You're going to spend $30, $50, $100 on a shirt you don't need, presumably. But you will get a shirt for it. But what's the actual value of that shirt? $2, $3? That's something. You're not getting nothing. And there's some emotional fulfillment to having another shirt for most people. But mostly you just taxed yourself voluntarily and gave that money to giant corporations that are importing, manufacturing, running the stores, and so forth. And major consumer economies run on this behavior of getting you to voluntarily damage yourself and give it away. Whereas places like Norway or Nicaragua, where we don't produce a whole lot, really encourage people that if you have excess funds and you could go do those things, spend it somewhere that actually benefits you. And there isn't this place to spend it to benefit society. So there's no financial encouragement, no incentivization for the government and society to really push you in super unhealthy ways. There's still some, right? I'll go have that extra beer, go to that restaurant and spend a little bit of extra money, splurge. Of course, that pressure is there, but it's much more minor, and filling your house with goods, collecting things just for the sake of collecting them, showing off how many things you own as if it's a sign of success rather than a sign of mental failure is completely different. Those things are flipped. So you don't want to have a house full of junk just to show that you were able to buy it in the past and don't have that financial power now, which is a really bizarre way to take it. But instead, they're like, build your bank accounts, build your real estate portfolio, open your own restaurant, start a factory if you have the wherewithal. That's the kind of stuff that they want to encourage, because those things actually grow the financial and economic power of the country and helps everyone within the country, rather than having enough money already, producing those things already, and moving that money from the poor to the rich voluntarily, because overall it makes the numbers in society and the things that the voters look to look better, even when they're not really. So that's the underlying pressure of why these things happen. It's important to understand that, one, this is a thing that most of my viewers are subject to every day, and many of the decisions that you make or the reasons that you make those decisions are being encouraged, are being pressured by that societal pressure at some level. And when you move to another country, there's a really good chance that you're going to move from a country where that is encouraged to a country where it makes no sense and they think you were crazy. And I say this a bit, moving to Nicaragua, which is an extreme example, the United States is the most consumer society, Nicaragua is one of the least. But in making that move, one of the things that we found is that our entire concept of shopping, of ownership of items has completely changed. We don't want to own things. We see that as a negative unless we need it. If you need something, you know, I my shoes are wearing out, I need a new pair of shoes. That's a need. There's really easy to assign value to that. But that extra pair of shoes that I only wear on special occasions, man, it's another thing in my closet, another thing to clean, another thing to remember where it is, another thing to have wear out because I let it sit so long rather than being used, right? I don't want to own superfluous items. I want to own very carefully chosen, good value items, right? That things that actually make sense, that I will actually use, and don't clutter my house, don't require me to move extra things. And we're just talking about ownership and moving, the same basic thought process of doing what's financially right, doing the thing that actually makes financial sense, rather than giving into the emotional easy path of claiming that your emotions are the only thing that matters in your personal life. Yes, at the end of the day, emotions are very important, but we give them this unlimited power that ultimately leads to buyer's remorse, leads to poverty, leads to a crippled life that, yeah, it can take a little bit to get past that. We grew up with this, many of us in consumer societies, and learning to identify that and saying, I can break free of this unhealthy psychological cycle and improve my life financially and eventually emotionally as well. Those things that, you know, buying on a sale is emotionally fulfilling in that 30 seconds, maybe 30 minutes, maybe even for a day or two. But in the long run, most people have a overall cumulative negative emotional effect from doing those things. But because it's front loaded, it's a little bit like doing drugs. Yeah, cocaine feels great when you first take it. But overall, over your lifetime, you are generally less healthy and less emotionally happy if you've been hooked on cocaine. And that sounds obvious when we talk about cocaine, but when we talk about consumer-driven shopping habits, we excuse it as if we're drug addicts. Okay, moving on a little bit, I want to talk about some comments that were made on the show and how these really can reflect on problems with the way that we may view the world when we're looking at, you know, and this is for everyone, right? You're moving to a new place. You are easily going to be the target of people who are trying to take advantage of you, or a lot of people are targeted with conspiracy theories or all kinds of things when you are in a category of people who is considering moving. A lot of things come together. And of course, these things happen all the time to people who are not. But when we're talking about consumerism and your buying habits and decision-making, these things become important. So I've got a couple of comments that were made by Yosef, but they were made in reference to things that Yosef was doing, and I they were so important that I wanted to come back and talk about them, because both of them, I think, show what we're talking about, an emotional response, a misunderstanding of what it is we're discussing, and applying things based on those misunderstandings or that misinformation, and then coming to really dangerous conclusions based on it. Or not dangerous meaning like you're in danger, but dangerous like it's easy to get tricked and lose money or lose your data or whatever, because you're reacting emotionally to something that may not be understood. So the first thing was a comment about how we needed to be really wary of the cloud, because the cloud is owned by a couple large monopolies and their ties to government or whatever. Now, big companies and their ties to government, that's pretty much a given. One could very easily argue that it's impossible to be a large company in the United States without actually being an arm of the government to some degree. And there's a really good case to be made for that without going down a conspiracy theory path or anything, just basic how the American economy works and how it's likely to work. Fine. However, there's something much more basic here. Let's start with the cloud. Why is anyone talking about the cloud in reference to anything that we discussed with Yosef? Yosef wasn't talking about the cloud. I wasn't talking about the cloud. That didn't come up. So the fact that this comes up as a comment, and I understand the word cloud came up, but the cloud did not, is important, because the word cloud is one of these things that is bantered about, and it's mostly bantered about because there is a concept of cloud computing. It's a very specific thing within IT circles that no non-high-level architectural engineering professional should ever say, because there is no chance that you understand it, and there is even less chance, and I mean zero and negative, that the person you're speaking to will understand it, even if you did. And the chances that the two of you could figure out in what way both of you misunderstand it is basically impossible. This is a term so unbelievably difficult that I would easily venture that 99% of people who are full-time working IT professionals, the only field that has any hope of understanding this term, don't even know where to approach it from. This is so misunderstood, even within its own field, that outside of its field, it is not understood at all. But it's a very powerful technology and approach and paradigm from 20 years ago, right? This is not a new thing. It's 22 years old. So this is a lot of us feel like this is kind of a new thing until you start saying, it's been 22 years. And you're like, dear Lord, entire careers rise and fall during the time that this has been a major thing. So this is not a flash in the pan. This is not a new thing. There's nobody who can present it as up and coming or the hot new. That was 2002 to 2005. We're way past that now. Okay. So because that was this really important, cool technology invented at Amazon, just coincidentally, a lot of people started taking this thing they didn't understand, but they knew that it was in the news. They knew that it was important. They knew it was game changing to someone, but they didn't know who. And they wanted everything to sell based on it. So people who did marketing and people who wanted to sound cool started slapping this term on anything and everything that they could think of, right down to just your desktop, your laptop. People will call it a personal cloud. Basically, they've taken computers and replaced the word cloud. They've taken monitor, replaced the word cloud. You name it, they've replaced it with the word cloud, no matter how far it is from what cloud computing was supposed to be. And I'm not even going to try to explain what it actually is. Now, that is cloud computing. In this response that was given, the thing that was used was the term the cloud. Now, the cloud refers to one and only one thing, and that is the entire online digital world, meaning the internet, all the things that connect to the internet, and all things that are internet-like that may not be connected to the internet, whether or not they actually use internet technologies, as long as they use networking technologies. So this is something that has been around basically since the 1950s, 60s, and is far larger than the internet. It is the entire digital world online. So this is a huge concept, and it is a concept, right? Just like the real world is its alternative concept, right? We have, we generally, when we're talking about this, we don't have to explain it that deeply, but I feel we have to go into it a little bit. The entire universe of jobs, right? We go to work, we eat meals, we have friends, we grow old, we have pets, all these things happen in the real world. And we have this amazingly large universe of that is a subset of the real world that is our digital persona. And this is not some special technology. This is every website, every email, every social media, every downloadable video game, online multiplayer, like everything, the entire digital world is the cloud, right? So this is a useless term in general to use until you're literally referring to the difference between real life and not real life, right? We don't want to say your digital life, so we say the cloud, right? And so it's a basically useless term. And most importantly, we can never assign things to it, like ownership. Well, a few companies own the cloud. What? That's like saying a few companies own real life. And we had a video probably about a year ago, maybe two, where people kept asking me, how do I find a job online? And I'm like, so in the cloud, right? Online. So that's the same as saying, how do I find a job? And I'm like, I can't explain to you the entire universe of becoming proficient in a thing, looking for a job, interviewing, accepting a job, working a job. Like, that's way too broad. I mean, we can talk about those things if people need to know, how do you find a job? Well, we can talk about that. But asking, how do I find an online job? That is such a massive subset of jobs. That's not like, how do I find a job at your bakery that opened on the corner? Do I walk in or is there a place I can submit it? Like, that's a really concrete thing to ask. But when you say, how do I find an online job? How do I find a job in the cloud? You're talking about hundreds of millions of different jobs, right? There is as many jobs online today as there were jobs total in the world, say 150 years ago. So to ask, how do you find a job? It's just massive question. Well, the same thing. How does a company own real life? No company owns real life. I know people are going to, this is where conspiracy theories happen, right? Oh, there are some companies that own your life and everything, right? No, that's obviously not true. But people say that stuff and some people actually believe it. But that kind of reaction is what we're dealing with, right? This idea that there is just a handful of companies, they happen to be American companies, and they don't just own the life in America, they own the world. And that's just not the case. Amazon has effectively no presence here whatsoever. Google has no presence here whatsoever. Microsoft has a minuscule presence here, and so forth. The companies that people will say own everything turns out own extremely little in the grand sense. And that's just what they actually physically own. To talk about owning real life, do they own the air? Do they own the planets? Do they own our thoughts, our effort? Like, what do you mean by owning real life? And if you can't define it for real life, the cloud is exactly the same. There's no differentiation except that one is digital and one is the not digital portion. Just two ways of designating real life. And so the idea that a company owns it, the idea that you should be scared of the online world or to be scared of real life, these are weird concepts. I understand real life is where you actually get hit with, a hammer in the face when you're not looking, right? Okay. Yes, real life does come with risks, I guess. And the digital world is where people can, bully you emotionally and you can become really upset or you could be lied to just like in real life. So, I mean, yes, in real life, you do have to be wary, I guess. But the idea of saying you need to be wary, it's real life, sounds insane. And if that doesn't sound completely reasonable, flipping it and saying you should be wary in the cloud, what does that mean? What are you implying? Now, the thing that worries me is that we were talking about things that were completely not related to cloud, the cloud or cloud computing in any way, things like cloud storage. Cloud storage, again, marketing term, we slapped cloud on something clearly not related to cloud in any way as a marketing term. A lot of people understand what we mean when we say cloud storage, but one thing you definitely need to know is it in no way means the cloud, and it in no way means cloud computing. It's not connected to anything that uses the term cloud, purely a made-up BS word in this case. But it is still the word that we use because the thing that we call cloud computing grew up during this era of using these false marketing terms because people never hold industries accountable for flat out lying to them. Why? I don't know, but they don't. So here we are. It should be the companies are punished and they should, be honest about their products. And if their consumers treated them with respect and they treated their consumers with respect, then this stuff would be easy. But there's way more money in being dishonest, and people just look the other way all the time. So why would a company be honest? Doesn't matter. That's not what we're talking about. But that's what we were discussing, is this thing where you use a service that could be one that you own and you create. I create my own cloud services, my own cloud storage. I have cloud storage in my house, for example, and I use that for things. So that is a really important thing to understand, that if you say you can't use cloud storage to mean an alternative to your own storage, it doesn't mean that. Even within the marketing term, it does not mean that, right? So all these technologies don't mean the thing. They could never lead you to saying the cloud or to cloud computing. All right, so that came up implies that someone was very confused, and I'm sure a lot of people are, about what these technology means. And this is, as a business consultant, I constantly am faced with customers who make demands about technology knowing nothing about the words that they are using. They've been led to believe that they can make random decisions and that people should do what they say, no matter how harmful it is to them, no matter how illogical it is or how impossible it may be. And so a common one is to say, well, we need cloud storage, but they don't know what that means. So you could give them literally anything and say it's cloud storage, and how can they argue? All they wanted to know is that this thing that their buddy said to use, that he doesn't know what it is either, but the emperor's not wearing any clothes, right? You don't want to admit that you know your buddy is an idiot, and he doesn't want to admit he has no idea what he's saying. So he just says random words. You want to be keeping up with the Joneses, so you say you implement the same thing. You don't know if it's what he meant. You don't even know what he meant. You don't even know what you have, but everyone says they have cloud storage and everyone's happy. That's how the world actually works when it comes to this stuff. Working in technology is super depressing because almost all of our customers don't know what we've done. They don't know what work we've done. They don't know whether it's good or bad. They don't have any idea how it's supposed to work, how it should work, if it's secure, how to evaluate it. They don't bother, right? It's a really depressing field, and that's something that those of us who work in this field have to deal with every day, and it really is draining emotionally having to deal with that, but it's real. So when we're talking about this stuff, right, when we're talking about using certain technologies in order to ease or manage storage for stuff, so first of all, we were never suggesting that he move to the cloud. That never came up in any way whatsoever. We would never do such a thing because it's crazy to say things like you shouldn't do things in real life or shouldn't do things not in real in the digital world. Those are just conceptual levels we probably should never reference. But when it comes to cloud storage, that doesn't mean that someone else is holding it. It doesn't mean that it could go away. It doesn't imply that it is a service. It could be something that you have that travels with you. It could be something that you have that doesn't travel with you. There's a lot of options there. Now, there is a lot of services available that also provide that. And the idea that they could go away based on unconnected things is not logical and a very dangerous place to be, again, where we are taking a service, right? So we'll use a concrete example. Wasabi is a cloud storage provider where they're actually a service that you pay monthly by the amount that you are using. And if for some reason they were to go away, your data would be lost. Now, you never ever have to worry about your data with them, because if you have something that you don't want them to get access to, now the kind of stuff we're talking about, you really should never care. That would be super weird. But in theory, you could be providing them something that you want to keep secure. Well, you just encrypt it before you send it to them, and they have no access to it. It doesn't matter how much of a monopoly they are or are not. It doesn't matter if they're tied to the government or not. None of those things matter because it's not applicable. Your data is safe. A little bit of weird light there, just turning a slight bit. Your data is safe and protected in ways. It doesn't matter what anyone else does because only you have access to it if it's something that matters that way. If it's not, then just use it and not worry about those things. Those are false fears, right? Then there's the question of, well, what happens if that service goes away? You're using it to store your stuff. Well, in theory, you're only using it as a backup. So if it goes away, you annoyingly have to upload your things to a different service. No harm, no foul. They stop giving you a service. You stop paying. You use someone else. That's pretty straightforward. No major skin off your nose. Is it a little bit annoying? Sure, you got to set up a new service. Yes, you got to wait for it to all back up before you're protected again. No, this never happens, right? This is also, so all of this is based around a false fear that there's some company out there who simply goes away all the time based on who knows what, right? Companies making money are going to just throw your data away and take on lawsuits and lose money just because it's funny to lose your data. No, they're not going to do that. Could something tragic happen? Yes, but you have a backup. So really hard to imagine what this terrible thing would be. There's just so many layers of what are you trying to imply? None of it. I can't come up with a scenario where there's something to fear here, right? The level of protection you have is so high and the fears are so unfounded. It's much like if company A, right? So there's a manufacturing company in your hometown. They didn't do a good job and they went out of business one day. And then you go start a company unrelated to them. You start it 20 years later from a different town and you're not even in manufacturing. You're actually a insurance company. And someone says, you know what, I don't want to do business with your insurance company because I once heard the story of a manufacturing company that went out of business and I fear that you could go out of business too. Well, yes, you could go out of business, but not in any way because some other unrelated manufacturing company from 20 years ago also went out of business. That's unrelated. Coupling those things in our minds is a very dangerous place to go, and it is a logical fallacy that con artists use to trick us into having fear, uncertainty, and doubt about something where we can't establish any actual fear, uncertainty, and doubt. That is not to say that an online storage service, Backblaze, Wasabi, even Amazon S3, doesn't carry some kind of risk. Of course, it does, but the risk is so nominal that unless you're misusing it and saying, well, it's my only storage, and even then we already talked about, right? None of this stuff matters. The whole point in the discussion that led us to this was how DVDs and books and stuff weren't things that you had to bring with you because they're available for free online. And especially if you already own them, it's not even pirating, just download from online resources. And then you have that copy. Yes, you could bring your own copies with you. The point was you don't need to bother. That's a level of effort you don't have to go through if you don't want to, because everything is so available and protected already without you having to put in additional effort. If you want to put in your own effort, well, you're just taking it through the roof. You're going to a whole nother level, and that's absolutely fine. Lots of people want to do that. Sorry, I have a lot of bugs out here. It is the evening. And so this idea that you have to trust the cloud, well, you don't. Right? That's fundamental here. The whole point was you never have to trust anybody. You don't have to trust someone to back you up. You don't have to trust someone to provide it. You don't have to trust. You have total protection here. There's some extra things that may make for some convenience, but they're purely extra. They're not the actual source of your data. They're not the protection of your data. They're extra protection. They're ease of access or whatever. And that's it. And it's never the cloud. And it's not cloud computing. It's just some technologies that have cloud added into them that make things easier for you. So this whole idea that big companies, it doesn't matter if there's big monopolies. I'm not saying big monopolies are good. I'm not saying that being tied to the government is good. I'm not saying those things aren't true. What I'm saying is all those fears have absolutely no connection to anything we've been discussing in any logical way. And so that's where we have to be careful. These emotions come in. You start becoming emotionally tied to, oh, the cloud is controlled by big companies, right? It starts to become easy to trick people and say, oh, the cloud has this scary, you should be wary of the digital world because Amazon owns too much of it and Amazon does business with the US government. Well, there's a couple of these truths hidden in there, and then a bunch of just gibberish slapped on top. And it's easy, if we don't know what these technologies are, to react emotionally. And instead of, like we said at the beginning, being logical and applying business logic to the risk, to the finances, to the effort, and all those things, and saying, how does this actually affect me? Instead, we say, I'm scared of this thing, therefore I'm not going to evaluate what's safe and good and affordable for me. And instead, I'm going to do it based on an emotional reaction that is not only just an emotion, but an unfounded emotion. It's actually an inverse reaction. We shouldn't be reacting negatively to services that we have no reason to be emotional about. What we should be emotionally reacting is being angry and scared of whoever tried to trick us with that information, because those people are actually out to get us. I don't know what their goal is, but they're being dishonest with us, and they're playing with our illogical responses that we all have. This is predictable irrationality. Read the book, Predictably Irrational. It's really amazing and helps you dive into how we're all like this. In no way is this unique to any person. And because of that, it's really easy to use these tools to make people feel scared when there's nothing to be scared of, or to make them fear one thing based on some unrelated thing. These are tried and true psychological tricks by evil people who are out to put you in danger. That's where you should have the emotional reaction. Wow, that person thought so little of me, they tried to play this trick on me. I'm angry with them. And maybe you'll be irrationally angry and not just kind of angry, right? That's at least anger in the right direction rather than being scared of something that they just had to lie about because they couldn't find anything to honestly warn you about, right? That's how you need to look at it. We get a lot of that here in Nicaragua. We get implausible things said about Nicaragua every day because so many people who want to discredit it can't come up with any plausible problems with it. They don't know what to accuse it of that actually makes any sense that people wouldn't just immediately see through. So they go for things that are completely irrational and don't make any sense. And they hope that you will do no research and no critical thinking and just have an emotional reaction. And once you have that emotional reaction, then you'll start to mentally picture these things being true even when they're not, and your brain will try to reverse rationalize it. So those are techniques they're going to try to use. We're getting a little late in the day and it's getting a little bit dark, so I'm trying to find enough light to get the show wrapped up. I did a couple shows today and took my wife out to the beach to go to dinner today. We had a long lunch. It took them 2.5 hours to service lunch, so I'm a little bit later than I'd hoped to be. All right, the other thing that came up, same person posted this. One of the reasons that a lot of us like to own our things is that we're afraid of subscription services. I don't know if that's the term he used, but that's the point, that subscription services could go away. And what happens when they go away? All of your stuff is gone. Okay, so let's talk about this. Coming from, again, an IT and business consulting world, people being afraid of subscription services is a tried and true means of tricking them into paying for things at a much higher rate that don't make any sense for them. This entire world of fear of subscriptions is someone conning you. There's never, ever, ever, ever a time that you should be afraid or worried about something based on its pricing model. That's completely ludicrous. Now, individual services, right? We can go look at service A. It costs $5 and it's good service. You're getting a good value. That's a good product. Product B is thousands of dollars and you're getting no value from it. That's a bad product. Just like if you went to the store and said, this product is $5 and I really like it, and this product's $1,000 and I don't like it, right? We're used to the concept of value being individual to the purchase in the real world, in the traditional pricing models, right? You come up and you say, this is cheap and I'm getting a lot for it. That's a good value. This is not cheap and not a good value, so I'm not getting a good value for it. Really straightforward, but somehow when we start going to subscriptions, people lose their minds and all basic brain functions just go out the window, and you start to get people saying subscriptions are scary because you don't have a way to predict the value for forever in the future. Who cares? It's month to month. You're not making a big investment. You're making the investment for this month. If it provides you good value for this month, then great. If it doesn't provide you good value for next month, great. Stop using it. Evaluate as it goes. Now, there's reasons why subscriptions make sense in certain areas, just are the logical ways to go, and in other areas are not. But, and companies have figured out that getting people to be afraid of subscription is a really good way to get people who are emotional buyers to spend way too much money, way too much money. If you check most times, not all, then, and this is the key, they can't let it be all, just like it's, you know, real life versus the online world, the cloud, the idea of all things you can own versus all things you can license is the whole world, right? We're talking about the entire universe of commerce worldwide, universe wide, and just two different ways to approach it. So the idea that you can compare them and say that one is good and one is bad is absurd, beyond absurd. The moment someone says that, everyone should just shut that down and be like, whoa, this conversation makes no sense. Where are you trying to go with this? What do you think of me to say this kind of thing, right? But we don't. We've actually gotten to a point where people feel that they can say that a pricing model makes no sense. And imagine if we flipped it. If we actually looked at mainline services and evaluated them one by one, we would actually find that things like Apple Music or Google, you know, work suite or whatever it's called, or you know, Netflix movies, that you're actually paying very little compared to what it would cost to own libraries of things, which could be software or video games or anything, in order to actually own them. Right. And in one case with the subscriptions, they're constantly updating. We're getting newer versions of those things. We're getting new options, larger libraries, sometimes smaller, but generally larger. Right. They're competing for your dollars. And if you own them, well, it never grows because you just own them. And if you lose them, you lose them. And that's it. Right. If they update, you have to pay again. If it's all kinds of things. If we actually evaluate most of the services that people reference when they're talking about this world, it takes very little effort to show from a business perspective using a logic that the subscription actually cost less. And so it's easy to actually make a true argument that buying things is crazy. And when I was a kid, the idea of leasing a car was considered nuts. You don't own the car. But once people started learning basic math and started actually doing financial calculations with their cars, loads and loads of people said, you know what, actually I'm getting better value for leasing. Not everyone. And so it's actually an individual decision. In some cases, it makes more sense to own a car. In some cases, it makes more sense to lease a car. Leasing is just an old example of subscription services for automobiles. Literally, that's the main subscription service that people talk about. Other ones include buying a house or renting a house. And as we've talked about a lot on the show, yes, a lot of people, especially real estate agents, are out to scam you into thinking that buying a house is always good. But in reality, both buying and renting make sense. The market adjusts, and renting about 50% of the time is the better thing for you. And if you're in my type of audience, it's better about 95% of the time, because anyone who's considering moving ever is going to benefit from renting. Only people who would never take the consideration of relocating really benefit from owning houses in most circumstances. In some cases, you can benefit from the trading value. That's a little bit different. It is worth considering, but it's a separate factor from what we're normally talking about, and definitely different than what we're normally talking about here. We're not talking about items that you would plan to resell, your things that you want to own, at least from the discussion that prompted this. So that's the first piece. The idea that subscriptions are bad is crazy. And now let's back it up. Let's say that you did this thing. You've subscribed for a while. Let's say it's Apple Music. Okay, now I'm paying this tiny bit of money. Look, I had about 10,000 CDs, so you can imagine how much money that was worth. I collected them. I was an incredible idiot for doing it, but I had no better knowledge at the time. So I guess I wasn't really that big of an idiot, but I was a pretty big idiot. I really should have stopped and said, what value does owning all this ever going to be for me? And I didn't. So this is one of those life lessons that I learned, but I did it before there were subscription services, so whatever. The amount of money that I spent to collect those CDs is greater than I could spend in a lifetime on subscription services, and the amount I got, the quality of the music, much lower. It wasn't the high-def remastered stuff that we get today. It was CD quality, which is noticeably quite a bit lower than anything we use today. It was not convenient. It was all in the physical form and easily damaged. People would come over to my house, listen to music, and damage my discs all the time. It was super frustrating and ended friendships. It was a massive upfront expense when I could have spread that out over time. So many things could have made my money go a lot farther. So when it comes to things like music, this is a perfect example where people will constantly point to this as being good for subscription when clearly, or good to own and not subscribe, but all logic and financial numbers will point to subscription being way better. Not a little bit better, way better for normal people, and normally for a lot, right? I pay for a family of five, it's $30 a month. We're only paying $6 each. If we had CDs, you know, how do you even deal with that? They would all get ruined, all get lost. People would steal them. And then you're, and when you own things, they can be stolen. When you subscribe, they can't, or very difficult. So much protection comes with that. Now you say, but over time you keep paying that. What happens if the thing goes away? Okay, so what if the thing goes away, right? Who cares, right? Okay, I'm on Apple Music. It goes away? First of all, that's crazy to base all your life decisions on what if it goes away. That's like saying, what if your entire movie collection or your CDs collection is stolen? Well, it could be stolen, and Apple Music could be shut down, but neither is likely. Making your decisions based on only one of those having this thing happen, and which is more likely, way more likely to have your CD stolen than Apple shut down. People have had their CD stolen. Apple has never shut down. The track record goes clearly in one direction. There's also no reason to think that Apple would shut down. This Apple hates me and the whole thing's a trick just to make me angry because I don't have access to my music is ludicrous, but that's not the bigger thing. Okay, so Apple Music shuts down. Guess what? You don't have to do anymore. Pay for it. You don't have to. What you can do, though, is simply go to Spotify or go to Amazon Music or go to some new music that pops up, new music service that pops up to take the place of Apple. The market will provide for that demand. And none of that is what we were discussing at all anyway. So the point here, the first point, is to show that subscription services are not something to be feared. People who say they should be feared is what you need to fear. What you really need to do is evaluate. There are cases where owning things makes way more sense. There's cases where leasing things or licensing things or subscription services make way more sense. And a lot of it depends on what that thing is And sometimes there are hybrid vendors that kind of mix the two together. So you get some of the benefits that you associate with one in the other model and so forth. Examples are GOG and Steam for video games. You actually buy them, you don't lease them, but they treat it much like a lease service where they hold it for you and they update it for you and do a bunch of things. But what if they went away? Nope, with Steam, you actually lose everything. So even though you bought it, it's not a subscription, it still goes away. So that completely defeats this mindset that buying gives you this protection. No. Subscribing might give you more protection in the case of those video games. But with GOG, they give you this protection of what you assume with ownership, but still give you the update stuff. So if GOG goes away, all your games are still yours. But if Steam goes away, they're not, right? So all these things, when you're using these, when people are telling you these things, like this is why subscriptions are bad, they're not talking about subscriptions. They're talking about one isolated and often imaginary situation that they've created in their head that doesn't play out in the real world. Either it's not a real service that they're talking about, or it doesn't apply broadly, or it's just coincidentally true for one or two services that they may know about, but not subscription services or buying products in general, right? They're assuming things incorrectly, which is a really common thing that we get all the time when doing these kinds of business analysis, especially going back to cloud. When I have customers that say, oh, I want to go cloud because, and then when they get the cloud thing that they demanded, it doesn't do the thing they want. And they go, but it's cloud. We say, right? Why would you think it would do that? That term means nothing related to what you were expecting as results. Why didn't you tell us what your goal was instead of telling us to go cloud? Had you told us our goals, not going cloud would have provided for that, maybe, right, in that particular case. But that comes up a lot specifically, and the same thing is happening here with subscriptions. But all of that still brings us back to, we never mentioned subscriptions. When Yosef and I were discussing this, at no point did Yosef or I ever bring up subscription services. So that this was used as logic, this is a straw man beyond the fact that the straw man itself was fake. So first we tore apart the straw man, but now we're going to show that this entire logic thread was a misdirection. In the talk, Yosef was talking about wanting to take his physical stuff that he owned and bring the physical media with him. And I was discussing why I felt it would be more valuable to not bring the physical media with him, but to only transfer the digital, the actual movies or books, not the physical paper or physical plastic that those things are burned on, and just move it all digitally. At no point is there the slightest hint of going to a subscription service in there. I don't know any subscription service that would allow for that. So this is a case where it's not only not what we were talking about, but it's not even possible, so as far as I know. So I have no idea why subscription was brought up in context of this. But it's important to understand that Yosef and I were talking about two utterly different approaches to you having complete and total ownership of your data. Now, I agree. In many cases, subscription services will be superior, but they rarely 100%. In many of the cases of the things we were talking about, it's impossible to only use one or the other. A whole bunch of media is only available via subscription. Now, we're talking movies here mostly and not music. It's rare for there to be music that is only on subscription. However, it's becoming more and more these days that there's less and less ability to buy music just because that subscription is how it all works. But you can normally buy music still. Movies, however, there are tons of movies that are released on things like Amazon Prime and Netflix and so forth that never come out in a form that you can buy them. You can only have a subscription service to get them. And there are a lot of other movies that never come out on subscription and can only be purchased through buying them. And if you want everything, you have to have a million subscription services and buy all kinds of things. So in this particular world that we're talking about with movies, you have no options. You have to use what's available. There are some things for sure that have overlap, but there's no point at which we can have a discussion about someone's collection and say you're going to consider subscription. There's no subscription that exists that gives those kinds of options, right? So this is a completely nonsensical thing to be discussing in this context because it doesn't exist. And for books, it's basically the same thing. There's loads of books you can buy that you can't get on any subscription service. There aren't that many book subscription services that I'm aware of. A handful, yes, but not a ton. And so if you're looking at those, they're going to be super, super limited. My own book, right, which is published, now it's a technology book, so not of very much interest here, but that is only available through a couple subscription services. It is available through Amazon Kindle. It is available through the Humble Bundle, but it is generally something you have to buy, whether it's in paper or direct print from the publisher, Pact Publishing, or you can buy it through Amazon Kindle, as an example. all those things exist as ways to buy it, but subscription services really aren't available for it. So when we're talking about this, Yosef and I were discussing two different forms, physical forms of owning the same thing. We weren't talking about changing what he owned. We weren't talking about using a subscription service. We weren't talking about putting them online. Or if we were going to put them online in any sense, it was only to ease the transfer or to protect his transfer, meaning he would have a copy with him that he traveled with, but keep a copy on a cloud service, right? On a hosted service by another person that probably is cloud storage. There's a lot of just maybes in this, right? A lot of different ways you could do this, where all this stuff is also kept. So if for any reason his own equipment is stolen or broken or whatever, that he can just download it again and keep two copies so he has protection, right? But that's about backups. It's not about cloud stuff, right? That's a completely different thing. And so the idea that subscription came into this, just like cloud coming into this discussion, while these may just be random points of fear that someone has, they aren't applicable to the discussion that Yosef and I were having, but they do show just the lengths to which people will go to create emotional frameworks to be afraid of modern technology, of things that are perceived as being less secure, even when they're often more secure, or see changes in society, because subscription services, right, have been around for forever, back to Roman times, I'm sure, for certain things. But today, they're a little bit more popular for things where they have learned they make way more sense. Working in the software space, buying software is completely idiotic. You need to be in a subscription service. If your vendor doesn't provide a subscription service for most of your software, you probably need to rethink your vendor, because what you want is a guaranteed ongoing support that you can cut off their money if they aren't providing the product as they promised to do, if they're not providing ongoing support, because software is a living thing. It's not like movies or music where you get a copy and it's good for eternity. You'll always be able to use it. Software is a living thing. It needs to support the underlying operating system. It needs to be updated and patched in order to stay safe and working, and not just sometime in the future, all the time. If you're not paying all the time for that, chances are no one is fixing that for you. It's pretty unlikely, because there's no incentive. If you buy a piece of software and you own it, that they're going to keep updating it on your behalf and sending you free copies of things you're not paying for anymore. Maybe they'll do it for a limited time as part of the deal, but nobody does that in perpetuity, or basically no one does. That makes no financial sense for them, and is crippling for a software company. But doing a subscription service allows you to tie something you're actually using to actually getting it working and supporting. Well, this is a very deep discussion we can do on my other channel where we talk about software engineering, but it is a really basic thing that anyone who understands software will tell you: buying software is nonsensical, completely nonsensical. It is only subscription that makes sense because of the way that software fundamentally works, and it is different than most of the things that most people buy on a regular basis. So we're used to things like static objects, right? A pencil, a chair, a car, a movie. They don't change over time. We just need to make sure they don't become damaged, that they don't get stolen, and so forth. But when it comes to software, it is a living entity that needs to be treated in that sense. So completely different worlds. So it's completely viable to buy all the things that we're talking about. It's whether buying provides the option for the things you want. I want to be able to watch Stranger Things. You cannot buy that, period. It's not an option. You must have a subscription service. So it doesn't matter what my opinion on those things are. That's how you get it. Now, the thing that we were talking is that there's lots of different ways to access things that you already own, whether it's how you get the initial copy, or how you get the copy you're going to use, or how you access it once you are ready to use it. Those are the things we were talking about, not subscription services. At the end of the day, the thing that we're going to circle back to the beginning, my whole point was you need to be making rational, thoughtful decisions. Try to look for when you're being emotional, when you're afraid of something. If you're afraid of something like subscription services, if you are afraid of not owning things, that's exactly what we're talking about. That's hoarding taking over. That's emotional failures causing you to stop using logic and start fearing things based on not understanding them. And obviously, people fear the unknown. They fear things they don't know what it is. So if you don't know what cloud computing is, you don't know what the cloud is, you don't know what people are talking about with cloud storage, you don't know what subscriptions actually are, you're not sure what it means to own things in the modern world, especially in the digital world, then it's easy to become fearful of these things and start applying this mythical concept to them, that all these terrible things can happen, and both forget that those things are driven by market pressure and they're not just going to happen out of nowhere. Just like, oh, you're flying in a plane, you never know when the pilot's just going to crash into a mountain. Well, can they? In some cases, they might be able to, but does that really happen in real life? No, it really doesn't, right? So being fearful of something that doesn't really happen doesn't make sense. That's a failure of all of our emotional brains. But similarly, fearing something that we can easily mitigate against, right? Oh, I'm so scared that my subscription service goes away. Well, if it goes away, just get a different one, right? Move on, or then go buy things. You haven't lost the ability to buy because you didn't buy initially, right? You have all kinds of mitigations and protections. And so the things I think people, when people articulate their fears, I'm like, what? Where's the fear portion here? Where in all of this was it not? You just explained to me why it's a good decision, why there's nothing to fear, but your response is, but I'm afraid of it, but I want to do this other thing after I explained why it's good. That's what we got to get away from. When you have a feeling of fear, when you have a feeling of concern like that, step back and go, whoa, whoa, I'm reacting incorrectly. Something is wrong in me. There should never be fear in a financial calculation. This is simply about how do I get the most with spending the least so that my life is the best. Right? There's no fear in improvement. There's no fear in getting more. There's no fear in doing better. You should be afraid of not doing those things. The moment we're afraid of doing what's good for us and not afraid of hurting ourselves, that's where our brains are failing us and are becoming our own enemies. Watch out for that. You can do a lot to improve your life. And all this comes back to, as an expat, all of our decisions are magnified. So this is a chance in your life to make really big, important decisions and to make them well, and making them very foolishly, right? And this is a common one. People will move to Costa Rica because they're afraid of safe countries. They'll move to the most dangerous country in the region, for tourists at least, because they are afraid of the countries that are safe. That makes no sense. You're not afraid of violent crime. You're afraid of statistics or something. Like, it's very strange. But people routinely say that they're going to go to a place that's very expensive because they're afraid of cheap places, that they'll go to places that are have a lot of violent crime because they're afraid of low violent crime. And you're like, what kind of weird logic is bringing your brain to be able to articulate that and make you still do it, right? Something's wrong. And I want to make you guys in my audience able to see through that for other people and yourselves and improve your decision-making so that you can end up safe, happy, and getting more for the effort that you put in. Thanks for joining me. Like and subscribe. If you'd like to help support the channel, you can buy me a coffee at buymeacoffee.com/Scott Allen Miller. As always, that comes straight to me. It's like Patreon helps support the channel. I need cameras and lights, apparently, and more time to do the show. And as always, I will see all of you tomorrow.